We'll be right back. We'll be right back. I was playing with you. I didn't hear you too. Excuse me, everybody. I'm a woman.
All of my life, I've never fit. But I won't complain and I won't quit. I am enormous. Get used to it. Everyone tells me I'm too much. Maybe it's just you're not enough for me. Can't you see? I'm the kind of woman I'm supposed to be.
Why? Bloody Storytelling! Can't believe all the people that we have here from all over the world. We have people in Australia and UK and Portland and Seattle, San Francisco, all over the East Coast tonight to not only attend Body Storytelling's live stream, but to celebrate somebody who has affected so many of our lives. I'd love to see in the chat, how many people are here for the very first time tonight? I'm always curious as to who's brand new to the show. Raise hand. Well, especially for you, I'm going to explain how this show is going to work tonight so that you know what to expect. I'm going to give you a little background first. Our technical director is going to explain the general housekeeping thing so everybody knows how this is going to work and you can just settle in on your couch or your bed, because a lot of y'all watch in bed. We know you're fucking in your bed. Sometimes you turn your cameras off, sometimes you don't. But Body Storytelling is the original sex and storytelling series. I am sexual folklorist Dixie De La Tour. I founded this almost 14 years ago when I realized that there was no place for us to tell our true stories about sex, kink, or gender. And so it started as a small coffee clutch in San Francisco. We've toured around the US a few times, and we were often in Seattle every single month until COVID hit. So I have been in Seattle as much as I've been on stage in San Francisco. I love Seattle, and in particular, I love Elena Gabosch. So this was our opportunity to come together and utilize the live stream that was already planned so that we could celebrate, even though we're hundreds of miles apart. So as I said, I have been doing this for almost 14 years. We've got a podcast, which has won Best Of from Oprah Magazine. Who knew she talked about dirty stuff? We've got Best Of from Mashable, from Women's Health, from Esquire, from Uprux, from GQ, and all of those places. We have a huge list of Best Ofs, which is great because I have no fucking idea what I'm doing. And the reason it works as well as it works is because the live stream technical director is also the podcast producer. So before we get to switching over to him, I need to introduce a concept to you. The concept is called applause titties. I have been given giant hooters, and their job is to make people applaud. We're all at home, at live streams, sometimes at live shows, you get settled in, you just kind of are not really there. You forget, you golf clap. So if you don't have your clap emojis ready yet, I want to hear the panelists make a bunch of noise, because right now is how we let each other know that we're here in person and we're going to do this thing together. Are y'all excited about tonight's show?
Yeah.
Namaste, namatitty. This is what we do to make sure that the performers feel like they are performing to people who are actually here in person, to let the people who've worked really hard on this show and have scheduled and written and gotten ready for this. There's been a lot of work that has gone into this live stream. So each person that I'm about to introduce is going to need a fuck ton of love, and that's what my applause titties do. So the reason we are gathered here tonight and the live stream works so well is because our podcast producer / live stream technical director is behind the controls. Y'all can send me all the private messages you want. I ain't gonna do you a goddamn bit of good of difference, because I don't do anything but shake my titties. So here's the person who's in charge of everything. Please say hello to our podcast producer, our live stream technical director. He is in Denver, Colorado right now. Say hello to Marty Garcia.
Woo! Thank you, Marty. Mm-hmm. Hello, y'all. Thank you for joining us tonight. I just wanted to go over a couple of housekeeping rules and whatnot. First one is volume and muting. I know there's a lot of new people here. And so while we do love to have an audience and love to hear your reactions, we don't want to do that clip out Zoom noise where everybody talks at the same time and you can't hear a thing. So what we're going to ask you to do is, if you're not a storyteller and you're on a computer, go down to your mute button and the little up caret arrow and go to your audio settings, uncheck the box that says automatically adjust microphone volume, and turn that slider volume right above it down to about 10-20%. So that way you're not competing with the storytellers. That would be great. Another thing I wanted to talk about was our QR codes. As storytellers appear, you'll see information about them pop up, and there'll be QR codes. If you take a picture with your phone, you'll see the option to click on that QR code and take you right to the website or right to the Venmo or whatever they're promoting tonight. And if you could do that for us, that would be awesome. A lot of people have worked really hard on these stories. So show them your appreciation. And if anything goes too fast for you or you miss some of the information, feel free to just email me. I'm Marty at bodystorytelling.com. And I'm happy to answer any of your questions or pass on any of the information that you might have missed, and I'll get you taken care of. So have a great time tonight. Thanks, y'all.
Thank you.
Woo! Thank you, Marty. Holy shit. Awesome. Marty has worked his ass off on this show, y'all. He has been nonstop, and we have a lot of special surprises for you tonight. I believe I have reminded our performers, but I want to remind them once again, if possible, I'd love for you to turn on the voice memo on your phone so that we can have the cleanest quality recording of your story that you're going to tell tonight, because Zoom quality is not optimum quality. And we're hoping to put you on the podcast. So whatever you can do, recording it, even if it's QuickTime, if it's your voice memo on your phone, that really helps us a lot. So we have a brand new musical act tonight. Remember how I said all that about the applause ditties? We're going to do that too. All the way from Australia, which, guess what? It's tomorrow in Australia. If you need any winning lottery numbers, just ask him, because he already knows what tomorrow is. It's the middle of the day in Australia, and he has won Best Cabaret, Best Performer. He's been part of Adelaide Fringe, Edinburgh Fringe. He has toured all over the world. And I had heard from the incredible Shirley Gnome, who's performed for us a number of times, that we should definitely, definitely have him at Body Storytelling. Well, there's the thing about this brand new, you know, like the way we do shows now, he can be in Australia tomorrow and we can be here on Saturday night in the US, and he can still kick off our show. So please welcome, for the very first time to Body Storytelling, make some noise for Grant Buzet.
G'day, it's Grant Buzet, right from Australia. It is absolute pleasure to perform for Body Storytelling. And I know there's a few questions that you all have for me before I start. I'm going to answer them straight away. Yes, I surf. And two, yes, I like my hair pulled. Okay, now with that knowledge, let's kick off this amazing show with an ode to the booty and in all its juicy gloriness. Warning, take due care, for every woman out there has a derriere that can bring a man to his knees, just begging for a cheeky squeeze. So celebrate your curves, your busty physique, celebrate the fact you are unique. And when you sit, enjoy the ride, bounce up and down and side to side, hourglass, apple, or pear. You You can make them stop and stare. Tie, burn, flabby, loose. Don't matter, the caboose was built to seduce, yeah. I like big titties, my friends who say, but I prefer a big booty. For it's not the front that leaves you wanting more. It's the last thing you see when she walks out that door. I am a bum man, I'm proud to say, and I realize there will come a day where bums will sag or lose their bounce or just gain weight, yeah, ounce by ounce. But it's not the rump that interests me, it's the queen that sits on the cushion seat, the confident woman above the glute that leaves me speechless, that leaves me mute. So cast aside your fears and doubts. You're all beautiful inside and out. You're sexy, powerful, and delicious. And that is why you'll always be bootylicious. You're bootylicious, baby. Oh, you're bootylicious, baby. Sing it with me. Bounce, 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 yeah. Bounce, 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 bounce that booty. Bounce, 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 yeah. Bounce, 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 sing it. Bounce, 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 bounce. Bounce, 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 bounce that booty. Bounce, 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 bounce. Bounce that bootylicious booty, baby, bounce it for me now. Ooh, yeah. You'll always be delicious. Thank you.
Yeah. Woo! Woo!
Yeah. Woohoo!
Huzzah! Woo!
Have a great show. I know it's going to be a good show because I'm in the future, so it's going to be great.
Brave reviews. Thanks. Can you tell us any in advance? Any reviews that you can pick off of the future and tell us how this show went?
Look, it's going to be nominated for the best podcast of the year award. You know,
for a live stream, that is a good thing.
Yeah, yeah. It's just instant.
I think I heard that one of the high points is that Grant Bouzé is going to be back at the end of the show to perform another song for us. Is that true?
It is true. Got one more.
I would like to know that people are excited about that. Can the chat or the sound let us know that you would like to have a little bit?
Oh, yes.
Yes, please.
Oh, yeah.
Nice. Right.
Oh, my God.
My booty can't wait.
Boobies.
They are horny for you, Grant.
Look at those.
I'm sorry we objectified you like this, but it's
no, crazy. No.
But
no,
look at that hair. How can we not?
I just want to pet him.
Just the right amount. Just the right amount.
Gorgeous.
Hey, Marty. Oh, there we go. There's Grant's information. You can tip Grant. There is Grant's PayPal. There's information about Grant. Been on a soap opera in Australia. He's done TEDx. Fucker, I want to do a TEDx. And has performed all over the world. And when tours come back, we'll get to see him when he comes and he performs at Body Storytelling for us, I hope, on
Definitely.
One of our stages out here.
Definitely.
Hey, Marty, can you cut to the gallery so we can see some of the people who are attending here tonight? We have a lot of new faces.
Yep, we should be on gallery view now. If it's not showing, you might want to change your point of view up in the upper right-hand corner.
Okay, I just switched to gallery. Look at those faces.
Ooh.
Some faces and names. Wave, everybody, hi! Faces I haven't seen in a long time, not on the internet or in person for a very long time, and some really, y'all decked out tonight. I really appreciate how you threw everything at it. You look great. So many of you, oh, I just got titty shook by cunning minx. God damn.
It's about damn time.
So I believe our honored guest is here. Normally you put your special guest at the very end of the show, but Elena Gabosch has been dealing with a lot of health issues, and we wanted to do this while she was at the top of her game. Early in the show is probably when her energy is best. I have not talked to her today. I have swapped some text messages, but that is it. So when you hear from her in just a few minutes, you're going to be hearing the first words that I've heard from her too. So we're all going to find out together how she's feeling, how she's doing. I know she looks beautiful because she's always fucking beautiful. If you don't know Elena Gabosch, which many of you are here tonight for her, she was the executive director of the Center for Sex Positive Culture, the Foundation for Sex Positive Culture. She was on the board of National Coalition for Sexual Freedom. She worked with Sex Workers Outreach Project. She has been around the sex positive scene since about 1990. And so many of the things that we have, the entitlements that we enjoy today, we have because she broke the ground for us. She's the one who did all the hard work, starting foundations, doing the paperwork, creating gathering places for perverts so they could all come together and feel okay with themselves, feel less shame, feel less stigma about who they are or what they loved. And think about that, 1990 was a long time ago. People had a different outlook. So she changed hearts and minds. And the way she did it is because she's the fucking embodiment of joy. I can't believe she's here because she's not been feeling well. We're gonna get her from her hospital bed. I need all your clap emojis. I need all your noise. I need everything. Please welcome Elena Gabosch.
Hello.
Hey.
Oh my God, it's good to be here. I can't believe we're all here. Thank you so much. This is amazing. So Dixie, you want to know how I'm feeling?
Yeah.
I'm feeling pretty happy, and I'm feeling actually overjoyed. I can't believe this. I'm here. I'm tired. I will give you that heads up. And although I slept almost all day, thanks to Mac and Don, they kept me asleep, which is good because that way I rested well so I could get ready for this evening. So a little bit about me. I'm gonna belch. Just warn you. Right now, in fact. Hopefully it doesn't lead to throwing up, but it might, just a warning. I'm just gonna give you guys all those trigger warnings. Whatever. But overall, I'm doing really good today. And so we'll see how long I can last. I'm so thrilled to see. I'm seeing people that I haven't seen in ages on here. And this is just like so awesome. Thank you for being here for me. I'm just kind of overwhelmed right now. So what do you want to know about me and sex, Dixie?
What do I want to know about you? Well, I had this great opportunity to interview you last week on Zoom
That's right.
Because we weren't sure if you were going to feel well enough to do this tonight. Okay. I got to learn a lot about who you are, how you became the pervert little girl in Idaho, moves off to the big city. would you share with us the Portland story? Because that feels like an origin story of how you became this.
Oh, okay, yeah. So I've had a couple experiences in Portland that changed my life. And when was it? In the early 70s. Mid-70s. I was living down in Portland, and I was like 19, 20. I wasn't even 21 yet. And I'm living down in Portland, and I'm just out wandering around. I'd barely come to grasp of the fact that I might be bisexual. And I'd had a lover before, a female lover, but I just didn't really embrace my sexuality yet. So I'm wandering around and I come across this little gated community of things. There were like people handing out flyers and people handing out different stuff. And about halfway through, I realized that I was in Portland's first gay pride event, which was like, well, this is cool. I didn't know they were having one. And I'm wandering through Portland and through this little tiny event. I mean, it was really small. It was mostly just handouts and chance to talk to people. And the way where I was at, it was like there was this like flat spot, and then it came down on stairs all the way down. And so I get to the edge of the stairs and I look down at the bottom of the stairs, and there's three guys. Two guys are holding a giant flag that shows pictures of people burning in hell. So I immediately knew what that was. And I was raised fundamentalist Christian, by the way. So this was like, oh, I recognize that. And so there was these people that were holding this burning in hell flag. And then a guy in front of them with them, obviously the minister, he had a big Bible, and he points at me, he goes, "You homosexual." And I'm like, "Talk to me?" He goes, "You queer." And back in the 70s, queer was a pejorative, right? And I said, "Are you talking to me?" And he started going, wow. He was spitting and sputtering. And I just, being raised fundamentalist, I knew answers to any of these questions he might have, and I knew to stay calm. So I just responded, like he made something about God wants me to go to hell or whatever. And I said, "Well, I believe that God says, judge not that you be judged yourself." And so we started having a biblical conversation. I was very calm. He spit and sputtered and spit and sputtered and spit and sputtered. And then at one moment, there was a pause between both of us. And I look around and there's 60 people standing there listening to us. And they applauded me. And I went, wow, these people are applauding me for what I have to say. This, I'm just like 19, 20. I was just this little kid, right? And it was just like one of the most amazing moments that I really got that I can make a difference just by having a conversation. And I never raised my voice. I never did anything, right? And that was like a big aha for me, that I could actually do that and make a difference without having to be mean or cruel or, you know, like some people were. And so that was my first experience at that. And it was a really profound experience. Now, flash forward, I don't know, a few months later, I sneak into a gay bar or a dyke bar, because I'm not of age yet. And this is my second big aha moment. And this one was one that really moved me too. And that was, I walk into this bar and I'm, like I said, I'm underage, so I'm not supposed to be there, but too bad. And I go to sit at the bar and there's this beautiful, beautiful blonde woman there. I mean, she's just gorgeous. And we get to talking. And in the conversation, and she's so out about who she is, she tells me that she's trans. And I'm like, seriously? And then remember, I'm a little cowgirl from Idaho, which means I ask stupid things. So one of the earliest things I ask is, "Did you cut it off?" In hindsight, that was like really bad to say. And to her credit, she said, "Yes." She said, "I'm post-op. This one made my heart just sing." Her parents, this is in the 70s. Her parents paid for her operation. And however, the sad part in her life was that in order to transition, especially back then, you had to live a year before you could physically transition, you had to live a year as who you were. And so she went to work after she talked to her therapist and stuff. And she told her boss, "I'm female." And her boss looks at her and says, "You're fired," because he didn't hire a female, he hired a male. And that meant she had no job. So she ended up doing what many, many trans women do. She became a sex worker. And she had a fabulous sense of humor. I remember one time she were talking and she goes, "Oh, if those guys that I was sucking their cock knew my cock was bigger than theirs, they would have just shit." Yeah. She was a delight. and she changed my life. So those were the two things, and I've had stuff all down the road, but those two things really changed how I look at the world and how I walk in the world. And it was so profound that I couldn't help but move forward and change other people's lives. And it just continued and continued and continued. And here I am, sex positive grandma now. So I was sex positive mom, but I'm sex positive grandma now.
I love that you learned to use your voice from the very beginning to speak.
I have to make a request, Dixie, is that my hearing is really bad today.
Okay.
So make sure that we, and we have it up, I think, as loud as it'll go, I think.
Can you hear me now?
I can.
Perfect. Okay. Can you hear me now?
No, I'm just.
I can hear you now.
Yes.
I love that the very first time you spoke to represent people, you spoke calmly and clearly and intelligently and battled somebody whose heart was filled with hate, and you gave just as good as you got, but you gave it to them perfectly. And then the trans woman that you met, even though you asked questions that you felt were ignorant, was so kind to you and educated you. And that's one of the reasons I love you as a storyteller, because you've always just shared your knowledge and had an open heart and just been so generous with people who just have never had experience. They've never known. You've opened the door and made everyone. I've been watching people talk about you in your group, and everybody is like, I remember the first time I saw you. I remember the look on your face, how you made me feel welcome, even though I didn't know what I was walking into. Everybody, 1,000+ people I've watched do that.
Thank you.
So I wanted to just have this opportunity. Thank you for doing this tonight. I'm astounded that you're sitting up. I'm astounded that you told a story. I can't believe we got you. Thank you for doing this. Do you want to tell the people who might not know what's going on about your health issues?
Oh yeah, absolutely. So I'm going to do a little backstory with it because it's kind of a fascinating story.
Okay.
Several years ago, I ended up becoming a nanny for a friend of mine who I've known since, I've known Llewellyn for so long, I can't imagine, since the 90s. He used to come into my cafe, Beyond the Edge Cafe. And so he asked me, I was getting ready to retire from the center, and I didn't really have anything to do. And Llewellyn's like, we need a nanny. We're adopting a 4-year-old girl from East Timor, which by the way is one of the poorest countries in the world, which that was an experience in itself. And we'd love for you to come be a nanny with us. And I'm like, sure, something new. I had retired, and so chance to travel. So he and his wife work for the American Embassy, and they were getting ready to go to Cyprus, actually, but they'd been in East Timor, and they wanted to adopt this little girl. So I helped with the proceeds of that, which a lot of fun stories and things like that. So I ended up in Europe. And while I was there, I got to travel. I got to go, it was so amazing. Because I got to go to Sweden and Hungary and I think that was later, but Sweden, England, I just got to travel all over. And I got to spend time with this wonderful little 4-year-old girl and her family. So then flash forward about a year or so, and turns out that they got transferred to Denmark, and they couldn't afford to bring me with them. And I'm like, I don't want to go back to the States. I'm having too much fun in Europe, so I want to do something different. And one of my friends who I met in Cyprus, he's like, well, my family's, his father was from, his father was from Cyprus, his mother was from Poland, excuse me. And he says, come to Poland, come to Krakow, and you can live there really cheap. Turns out that my Social Security was equivalent to an average income, which is kind of cool. And come and live with us. And I got family, I want to do you, blah, blah, blah. And about the same time, he got a new job in Poland. So, and this is a young gay man who's just like, Alex is one of the most wonderful people on the planet. I don't know if he's on here tonight, but if not, I will talk to him later. He's one of my favorite people and I love him very much. So Alex got me to Poland and I started enjoying, you know, traveling around Poland, which is, I know, kind of weird, but it was wonderful and beautiful. And I met a really cute little guy who was like 27 years old. At the time I was 65 and I became his mommy and that was fun. I actually popped a cherry or two that myself. I didn't know I had any left. And and we had this like amazing time. I got there. I don't remember when I got there, but about December, I started feeling ill. I had this weird stomach problems and weird, I gained water weight. I was just like, all this weird stuff was going on. So I started investigating. And so one thing I can say about living in Europe, it's a lot cheaper to deal with medical stuff than it is in the United States, like big time. The other thing is it takes a little longer to figure things out. So started going to doctors, started getting things tested. And we figured out, I've got some kind of cancer. And eventually we figured out that I had mesothelioma, which is caused by asbestos, which is probably something from when my dad remodeled the house. We don't know what it's caused, but it happened when I was a kid, a teenager. So all of a sudden I was very sick, like really sick. And I almost died. In fact, some of you are aware of the fact that I actually, my nickname is Jesus, because it took me only one day to come back from the dead. It took Jesus 3 days. I am definitely a little more efficient than Jesus. And that's because women are more efficient. But so I ended up going, dealing with this wonderful cancer thing, which was so exciting, not. And all of a sudden I had my first chemo, went back for my second chemo, and they're like, no, you're sick. You're too sick for chemo. And they sent me to another hospital to get fluid drained, because one of the things mesothelioma gives you is a fluid. And in the process of getting my fluid drained, was when I almost died. And then one of my amazing adopted children, Dilly, she flew all the way out to get me and flew me home, thinking that I wasn't going to live much longer. And that was June of last year. Mm-hmm. So, and I made it. And so I'm here. And I was doing pretty good until not too long ago. And I was trying different chemo practices and stuff. And I'm so thankful I came back to Seattle. I'm so thankful I came back to be with the people I love. Dawn and Mac, who I'm staying with, are two of the most incredible people in my life. I mean, there's a whole lot of you are incredible people in my life. I'm not discounting any of you, but they are putting up with me. And that's right, a big deal right there. They're putting up with me. And and I've been able to just have a really rich, full life, even while I'm dying. And I have no problem with that at all. So this is where I'm at. I'm kicking ass, taking names. And we're not sure how much longer I have to live. I was hoping I would finish before the end of the year, that I would stay here and make it through the end of the year. But there's a part of me right now that's thinking I'm going to probably be gone by Christmas. And I don't want to wish that kind of a Christmas gift on anybody. So I'm going to keep working at it. And hopefully my plan is, January 3rd or 4th. Other than that, but I don't know.
That's a good time. We'd love to have you into 2021 for sure.
I want to make sure. So that's a little short little version of all that's been going on in my life. And there's a lot more, but that's a big part of it.
I'm so glad you shared your life with us, that we got to hear your story from you. Often we hear people's stories secondhand from their relatives and their friends, and hearing it from you while you're here on the planet, that's the best fucking gift you could give anybody. You gave us an early Christmas gift. You gave us something to be grateful for Thanksgiving by being here tonight. And I don't know how much you know about this, because it's been on social media, and I know that you're laying in a hospital bed and you're on social media, but we have something special for you tonight. Do you have any idea?
I'm not sure. There's possible. No.
No. Okay.
Because there's several things it could be, so I'm not really sure. Yeah.
Speaking of which, did you have these? I had someone make prayer candles for you. Did you get your prayer candles?
I do.
I love that they are in the gallery. Julie and Mark made these. Look at that. I want them sitting next to your hospital bed when you need to be cheered up, because you're my patron saint for sure.
I love this. This is so cool.
That is not your surprise though. Marty, could you cut to Sister Vina and to Sister Frida for us so that they could get the ball rolling? There they are. Greetings, sisters. Can y'all give some applause? Give us some applause for the sisters.
Hello, sisters.
Hey.
Hey, sisters.
Hello, sisters.
Can you hear us?
I can.
Okay, good.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yes, darling. So, I'm Sister Frida Desire, and this is my partner, Sister. Well, she's not a sister. She seemed to be a sister. Novice Sister Venus and Furs, and we are of the San Francisco Sisters of Perpetual Indulgence. We also have in attendance a couple of other sisters from the San Francisco house here. We have Sister Nova Agra, Sister Carrie Mia Way, Sister Celine Dionysius, and we're all from the San Francisco house, but we also have people from and Sister Dana of Iniquity. It wasn't sure she was here. And then we also have the Abbey,
the Abbey of St. Joan.
The Abbey of St. Joan, all the way up north, you know, Northern California. They are also here in attendance.
Northern California.
Yes. Somewhere.
You know, up there.
Yeah, it's above you, Kaya.
Yeah. the sisters, as you might know, are a 40-year-old global order of queer nuns who engage in activism and philanthropy, and our mission is to promulgate universal joy and expiate stigmatic guilt. We don't do this alone. There are so many out there that are uplifting the community through their works and their words and their deeds every single day. And the sisters really like to acknowledge and recognize those exceptional individuals by canonizing them. I don't know if you've heard about this whole thing we do. And sainthood is our highest civilian honor.
It's our only civilian honor.
So tonight we are here to honor Elena Gabosch for her mighty contributions. And while saintings are usually done by the house, Elena's contributions are so mighty that the San Francisco house is partnering with Seattle's Abbey of St. Joan to confer the first ever double penetration sainting.
Woo!
It's history, history.
Sainting is partly about good deeds and what you do, but it also requires a miracle. So,
a miracle.
Oh!
That's a flying fish.
Elena, what's 2 times 2?
2 times 2, 4.
You made the fish multiply. It's a
multiplied fish.
Wow. You eminently demonstrated your worthiness for the singular honor of double penetration sainting. We now defer to Sister Gladys Panseroff of the Abbey of St. Joan.
I'm like confused. This is awesome.
Sister Gladys, we can barely see you. There you are.
I can't see your skin.
I can see your eyes.
Oh, I love it. Yay. Can't hear you.
Can't hear you.
You're still muted, girl.
Check
your batteries.
Not now.
Yeah, we can hear you now.
Can hear you.
Nope, you keep going in and out.
technical difficulties.
Yeah.
And that happens all the time, I'm sure.
Adventure.
Sister Gladys, can you try it without the headphones? Maybe just stand up a little bit and try it into your mic on your computer. Can't hear you.
I read lips.
Mikey, I need your help.
Oh my God. Hey, look at that.
Wow. I'm a saint.
You're a saint. I love that background.
Saint Alina, patron saint of bacon lovers, wet spots, and unabashed body.
Shall we read the name?
I love it. Thank you so much.
It went out of focus. Can we see that? What's the name?
That's amazing.
Saint Alina, the patron saint of bacon lovers, wet spots, and unabashed erotic expressions.
No.
Oh my God.
And in Sister the words of so many game shows, that's not all.
But wait, there's more.
Here it is. She has it.
So, Elena, when our order first started, you let us meet in your basement.
Oh. Hang on a second. I got to show you this, everybody. Look. Ah, upside down.
Whoever's speaking, we don't know who you are. So you have to identify.
It's Elena. Check this out. Very cool.
Awesome.
Beautiful.
It's too heavy.
There you go.
It's very beautiful.
Thank you. I'm so overwhelmed and overjoyed.
You know, before I started my process, they sainted me, so the bar is a little bit low, but we love you.
So, you Sister Angela Mercy here from the Sisters of the Mother House of Washington, also in Seattle. And like I was starting to say, you gave our order a place to meet when we first were founded in 1987. And you've always been there for us. For me personally, you were the first person to actually see me when I was 17 years old and wandered into your cafe.
Can't believe it that long. Yeah.
It meant so much to me to get to tell you thank you today earlier. And we're also choosing to saint you. So on this 21st day of November, 2020 Common Era, Sisters of the Mother House of Washington do confer upon you sainthood. Your years of service have provided indisputable evidence of your divinity through these miracles wrought by your hand.
Feeding the masses with a single pot of vegan chili.
Uniting the often divided kink community of Seattle, first through Seattle Kink Information Network, SKIN, and then through the creation of the Wet Spot. And finally, through your public appearances around the world to educate on kink, consent, and meaningful connections.
And then, probably the most pedestrian of your miracles, your death and resurrection 18 months ago. Then, there is, of course, the miracle that must be witnessed firsthand.
And probably the one that required the most divine intercession.
You have gotten the San Francisco Mother House, the Abbey of St. Joan, and somehow to agree unanimously, without debate, reservation, or hesitation.
On the indisputable fact that you are a saint.
Thanks.
So, henceforth among our order, you shall be known as Saint Jesus, all in the gay book. Patron Saint of
Kink,
Connection,
and Polycubes.
Your feast day is March 25th.
Your sacred dish is vegan chili with a side of bacon.
And your holy mantra is forever, fuck cancer, baby.
Yes.
So,
I love you. It's so good to see your face.
We love you too. And there's one more surprise, and I'm not even sure if Dixie is aware of this one. But I'd like to introduce really quickly representing the Indiana Crossroads Sisters, the Abbey of the Tinker of Bio, Sister Sonata and...
Hey, baby!
Yay!
Oh, you know, so we're just coming around the back and maybe sitting on your face a little. We're going to add an extra hole yeah. to the whole shebang. There you go. So I will add my, you pop more cherries for me than I can even tell you. Yeah, my first at the center, my first Hitachi. Oh my God, it's been a blast. I will just put that out there. Give you all that credit you've been claiming. So here's our story from Indiana. So there was Seattle, but in Indiana, the Indiana Crossroads Sisters also affirm our view of Alina as a saint. She has a special connection to the Hoosier heartland. She floated in and shared her wisdom with us as she traveled the country as a speaker at Kinky College and other cons. We will forever honor her with this prayer. Dearest Saint Alina, the traveling sage of the body tales, you traveled to the heartland from far away to lift us up with light and laughter, education and love. You brought the good word about love and consent, kink and joy, as you traveled from con to con, speaking your wisdom, showing off your trophy partners, and making connections between Midwestern cities and towns. We ask that you sustain us and inspire us to be bold, to act with love, and to claim our fierce intelligence as we spread the good news of joyful and safe relationships throughout the Hoosier Heartland.
Thank you, love.
Hey, well said.
Sister Frida and Sister Vina, did you read your sainthood, the name that you gave Alina?
I have to find it. We had actually, we're letting, we were going with them, but hang on. You and I are in here somewhere.
I believe it was Saint Wet Spot Sextacular Jesus of the Femdom Vine is what you originally talked about.
That was it. We thought that having all the sisters here jump in would be too much of a technical leap. There are some other sisters here, so if they'd like to jump in and say hello, please do.
Marty, can you put us on gallery so that Alina can see everybody's faces?
Nope.
Yeah.
I have lost count. How many people, how many orders just sainted Alina?
It's a quadruple penetration.
So that means
one in the stink and one in the mouth.
You know, she had an interesting experience with her nose once. I bet we can recreate it.
So there had never been a simultaneous sainting on this at the same time of two orders. And Alina, you're so exceptional. You just got sainted by four orders of the Sisters of Perpetual Indulgence at the same time.
Like
I didn't know that was happening. I had no idea that was happening.
Well, Alina,
she's worth every bit of it.
My titties love your titties.
Yeah, that got insanely out of control for a minute, but I'm so glad every second of it happened. Alina, we love you with every fucking drop of our being. That was so moving to me. If you can stay with us, I'd love for you to stay through the second half of the show. Just, you have some dear friends who are going to be telling stories in just a little bit. And I think the rest of the audience would like to ogle our guest from the land of tomorrow a little bit later on too. So
I'm
you guys-
hang out here as long as I can.
Yeah, and if you have to go, we totally understand, but I'm fucking grateful that you were able to make it tonight, that you're sitting upright. I haven't seen that in a while. You were laying down in a hospital bed the last time I saw you, and you look beautiful. You look incredible. Y'all, if you would like to donate to Alina's meal train, her caretakers, Mac and Dawn, are doing everything. In fact, Dawn just had knee surgery. So Mac is taking care of two people right now. I think that goes to Grubhub, DoorDash, and one other one. So if you'd like to feed Alina for the foreseeable future, there's a schedule, there's information. As you saw, we have QR codes. so that people can either get tips. All the performers are out of work during COVID. In Elena's case, let's buy her some great meals, her and her caretakers, so that she eats like the queen she is and enjoys all the meals. She has been doing an incredible job doing the bucket list we all want. She's been flying in a hot air balloon. She's been drinking $100 scotch. Every single day has been this adventure. Let's keep the adventure going.
Say $100.
Thank you to Mac. Thank you to Dawn. Thank you to Elena for being here. We're going to go to break right now.
And one second.
Yeah.
I got to unmute here. You're not muted. Oh, I am unmuted. One second. I want to clarify something, only because you don't get to do this kind of thing very often. It wasn't $100 scotch.
It was
$200, 241-year-old.
Wine.
It was wine, but it was, I hate chemo brain. Fuck that shit. It was starts with an M. It's a fancy, like, dinner wine.
Malbec?
No. It's sweet. It was like a port, but I just can't remember the name right offhand. But this wine, what was it?
Moscato.
Oh, Moscato. So this wine is the oldest wine available for sale in the world.
You go, girl.
And we got at this really fancy place for dinner, and I'm like, it was $200 for 1/3 of an ounce.
Jeez.
Best
you get it.
I did it.
We've always wanted to be you, and now we want to be you even more.
I figured, what the hell? I don't got much time left. I might as well do something really splurgy, and that was splurgy, and it was worth it. Yeah. And I took Don and Mac out to this really wonderful dinner that it was 9 courses, and every course had mushrooms involved in it. And it was an incredible evening. But drinking 240-year-old wine was, wow. And it was good. Wow. Yeah. Anyhow, now you can do what you got to do, and I'm going to watch.
Okay. We are now, that was the first half of our show. We are going to have a break. If you're the sort of person who needs to go to the bathroom, go to the bathroom. If you would like to move your booty, Marty is going to play DJ. Marty plays great music at the break. So get up, shake your ass, shake your tits, whatever you want to shake is fine. And he plays great music. So we'll be back in about 10 minutes with the second half of the show. And the more you shake it, the more you're the spotlight dancer. So let's see it, y'all.
Shake it, shake it.
Dancing, dancing, rapping the high with the one. you got a big booty.
Ooh.
Big, big booty, but you got a big booty.
See your eggs.
Big, big booty, but you got a big booty.
Go to work.
Big, big booty, but you.
Ain't that a freak?
Big, big.
Everybody's living the dream, starring in the show that we film on our phones, taking photos for pretend magazines. I don't want silver, don't want the bronze, I won't play Potsy, I play the Fonz. Every time I see a shiny thing on the screen, I think, hey, maybe that could be me. Silver, don't want the bronze, I won't play Potsy, I play the Fonz. Try to keep my head down, I just not care. Hey, what's that over there?
Everybody's running, 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 running.
life I've never fit, but I won't complain and I won't quit. I am enormous, get used to it. Everyone tells me I'm too much. Maybe it's just you're not enough for me. Can't you see? I'm the kind of woman I'm supposed to be. Hey, my vagina is 8 miles wide. Absolutely everyone can come inside. If you're ever frightened, just run and hide. My vagina is 8 miles wide.
Hey everybody, how you doing? Woo! Woo! That was a
wonderful.
We have never done anything like that before. I think everybody rolled with it. Can everybody make a huge round of applause for Marty, who is keeping up?
Yeah. Oh my God, Marty.
Yes, Marty. Yes, sir.
Dance party and everything like that. Marty, you're a fucking miracle worker.
Yes, he is.
And he made that illustration right there for Spank Bank. He illustrated me and he illustrated that spanking machine.
Nice.
Nice.
Wow. I'm exhausted. Is anybody else exhausted? That was a lot.
That was
so
a lot.
So many sisters. So Elena's got to be passed out in bed right now because not just telling a story or two from her life, but
I'm awake.
That's our woman.
Being sainted by that many houses, which has never happened before. She's always been a history maker and she just created history. Like, you were here for a moment that has never happened. And I'd be pretty fucking amazed if it ever happened again. I mean, Ruth Bader Ginsburg was sainted by posthumously by five houses, but not on the same night. Nobody's ever been sainted by that many sisters on the same night.
Not on Zoom, right?
Yeah.
We come together for Alina.
We really do come together.
And sometimes we come together for Elena. Tonight we come together for Elena. So we're going to go on with the second half of the show. I want to tell you a little bit about what's coming up. You might have noticed that we've gone down to live streams once a month while we wait for the whatever's happening in the world to figure itself out. There was so much distraction with the election that we just figured we would do shows less often. So I want to tell you about the next show. Tickets are already on sale. It is going to be on Saturday, December 12th. And we are going to be doing the theme Happy Endings, because God knows 2020 needs one. Can everybody see that?
Yes.
Can you see what Marty has created for you? There it is. We also have coming up, if you are one of our Patreon supporters, you get free tickets to not just live streams and the live stream replay, which lives on Patreon. We have special events coming up. There's a group called the Go Game, which does high tech events, and they are creating a special dirty trivia. We did one a couple of weeks ago. Everybody loved it, said it was the best thing they'd ever seen on Zoom. Look at that. You can do dirty Pictionary and draw a bunch of dicks. How cool is that?
Oh, look at that.
And it's not hosted by me. It's hosted by somebody who is really good at trivia. So it was really fun. We had a ton of our body fans play and get to meet each other. We have things where you get to guess which fact goes to which person. Dictionary. That is true.
I drew that dick.
Good job.
That one is going to be on Sunday, December 6th. That one's coming up soon. We will have our next live stream. That's going to be Happy Endings on December 12th. Tickets are already on sale. And let me show you one quick thing. Marty, if you could cut to me, let's show them what you get. You might have noticed we have a level called exhibitionists. Exhibitionists are what all the sisters are right now. They can see behind the scenes. They can see the chat, all of that. We are down to everybody knows I'm obsessed with butt plugs because they're non-gendered. Everybody has an asshole, right? We are down to just a few of our custom butt plugs. So if you would like to have this baby in your asshole with my little cartoon face peeking out at you, look at that.
Yes.
You can show you're a fan of the podcast. You can have me just happy as hell peeking out of the butthole at you. And so for Christmas, you get one of these, comes with a butt plug cozy because these things will roll off the table and then lube goes everywhere. It also comes with butt plug sticker designed by Nadia Vanilla, our podcast logo, and some buttons that say Body Got Me Laid and some other goodies like that. But we only have 5 or 6 of them left. So order them as soon as possible. And then we can get them in the mail to you so you can stick them in somebody's butt for Christmas or Hanukkah or whatever you want to do. Hanukkah. Yeah, I think Hanukkah is a great idea. And then we have one more thing, which is going to be spinner. Do we have the slide for spinner, Marty? Can y'all see that? There it is. So Spinner is created by our friend Eleanor O'Brien of Dance Naked Productions. She is doing a new dating and connection game. Now, typically Spinner works because she's based in Portland. Typically you have to live in the Portland area so that if y'all fall in love on the internet, that there's the likelihood that you're gonna meet in person. But Body Storytelling's fans are all over the world. So we are having her try a new version of it, which is going to be International Spinner. If you're one of our Patreon supporters, you get tickets for free. If you are not a Patreon supporter, you can play for $20. I think the games, there's breakout rooms, you can talk to strangers, you get lots of time to meet one-on-one, and it's low pressure. And Eleanor is a whiz at games. She is great at leading games. She's a hot redhead. She loves to be naked. She's probably gonna be naked on Zoom. She always is. And she created that just for us. And we're going to be promoting her new venture, this new spinner game. She knows about dating. So those are coming up. That's gonna be on December 19th. So right before Christmas, you can make a new friend. Everybody needs somebody to have Zoom sex or phone sex with. You can meet somebody new and kind of increase your likelihood of having some getting laid, even if it's on the internet, right before the holidays. So that's what's coming up for us. We are now going to resume what our show usually looks like. That just happened was not what usually happens. I'm so glad it happened, but we are going to get into stories now. Our next storyteller is somebody that I have been trying to get for so long. But they live all the way on the East Coast. We're here on the West Coast. It's never worked out until tonight. She has been featured in Vice, in Business Insider, in Rolling Stone. She wrote the top selling book on sex work on Amazon and loves to teach models and people about adult work. Amazing at business, amazing at marketing. And I'm sorry, I believe I fucked up the pronoun. The pronoun is Z. First time having this person, and I am so excited to have them. Please welcome Amberly Rothfield.
Thank you.
Hi.
Thank you so much. Sorry, nervous.
That was chaos.
That was chaos. Wasn't prepared for that. Bawled my eyes out. All right. So, hi, everybody. Stale popcorn, 2-3-day-old wine cooler, questionable of what actually is in there, and just staring at my phone, looking at it, thinking, I've fucking heard it all. I know I've heard it all this time. I don't want to go through this again. It was a typical night when you're 22 years old and a phone sex operator. Every night you just go through yet another fantasy with another customer that you walk away wondering, what the hell did I just listen to? No, scratch that. What did I just participate in? I mean, it was kind of hot, but also Dallas Daddy is not going to be very happy. We're just not going to tell him. It's not exactly something we're going to talk about at Thanksgiving. I met Bart about 2 years into being a phone sex operator, and I'd heard everything. And then when Bart shows up, everything flipped and turned upside down. It was normal. I'm getting ready to finish my shift. I've talked to several amazing clients that really get me jazzed. They have the hottest fantasies, and they're just a pleasure to talk to, even after we make sure they're nice and satisfied. Then comes Bart, last phone call of the night, and he gets on the phone. He's got this scratchy old guy voice, asks me, "Do you have a computer near you, darling? I need you to pull up the interwebs." Okay, Bart. I can pull up the interwebs for you, Bart. Where are we going on the interwebs tonight, Bart? I want to know if you've heard of this website. It's called Pornhub.
Yeah,
Bart, I've heard of Pornhub. All right, yeah. Let me just type that in. Okay, are you at the right site? It's P-O-R-N-H-U-B. Yes, you know how to spell it. I'm so happy. All right, Bart, yes. Gotcha. Got Pornhub up. Okay, what are we looking for? Is there anything specific you're into, Bart? Yeah, there's something that I really, really like. I like, well, I can't, I don't know. I'm trying to pull it up on my computer. Okay. Can you describe it to me? I don't know. Like, she's a brunette. Do you know any brunettes? I know a plethora of brunettes, Bart. What else does she look like? Well, she's really pretty. Mm-hmm. Oh, okay, Bart. All right. Well, what types of things are happening in the scene? Oh, well, you know, she's in a house and there's a pizza guy. Okay, we're getting somewhere. We've narrowed it down. We've got a location. We've got an action. We're going to be good. We're okay. What happens next? Well, the pizza guy really likes her. Okay, can we speed ahead, Bart? Okay. You know, it would be better. I wish you could see what was on my computer. I know exactly how to help you here, Bart. Type in this, TeamViewer. And of course, I spell out every single letter because Bart's not so tech savvy. I get him to download TeamViewer and we go through the very arduous process of connecting our two computers, but now I can see what's on Bart's computer. And even though I was a couple years into the phone sex game and I have done everything from barking like a chihuahua to learning what furries were at 19 when I thought back then anal was pretty freaking kinky, to going through every single role play you can think of, farm girl, pizza guy, copier person, plumber, absolutely everything, I wasn't prepared for what I saw next. So pulling up on his computer's running so super slow, and looking through his computer, there's 1,000 icons all over his screen. His complete desktop is covered with files that have these names like super sexy vegetarian college girls gone wild part 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Anal cookie cutter, what? cookie cutter anal. What the? Going through finding furries, lamb basting. What this is, okay. Like, I've heard about some weird titles. What is this? Is when I discovered the wide world of indie porn, and Bart seemed to be, rather, his PC seemed to be the museum of every type of porn that existed in this world. So I'm thinking, okay, so it's just your desktop. We need to like sort this. His computer's moving too slow. So I open other portions of his computer, his document section, his download folder. His download folder had not just indie, he also had some pristine productions such as college cheerleaders 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, because there's just absolutely so much that we did not learn in 1, 2, 3, or 4. He had gangbang content. This is also where I learned about the wide world of transgender porn. I'm very glad I learned about that, and so is my wife. I'm trying to like figure out what exactly was this video that he's looking for, because he also simultaneously has about 16 videos open and paused on the bottom. So finally we find out that he was looking at a particular video in which there actually wasn't even a pizza guy. It was a plumber. He did not get that right either. And we go through what seemed to be actually a pretty mundane scene when it comes to porn, as it could be, pretty straightforward boy girl. But after we go through watching it together and Bart has his happy ending, I ask Bart, why do you have this much porn on your computer? Well, I'm really scared that the internet one day is gonna shut down. People don't realize how much of a deal they've got. We've got all this free porn. Back in my day, you had to pay premium prices to have this type of porn. If you could get it for free, and I don't want it to shut down, and I'll be pornless. So suffice it to say, I thought in that moment of telling sweet Bart that there's such thing as external hard drives. But then I also realized how much time and effort that's going to take. But then I remembered I get paid per minute. So we scheduled yet another time in which I taught him how to use external hard drives so that the porn museum curator could take all of his porn and not just have massive numbers of PCs everywhere, and could actually formatively put them away so that the internet will never be without porn. But that really isn't the big lesson. The biggest lesson that I learned was in going through this massive library of porn, I always classify people to that point as you're straight, you're gay, you're bi, and there really was no in between. If I'm into this type of porn, I might not be into furries. I may not be into this, but Bart taught me a lot through my relationship with him, and became a long-term customer of mine, is that we're also multifaceted. There's so many different things that we're all into, and it's an absolutely beautiful thing. We don't have to be pigeonholed into the things that we hold the best. So I'm not sure over the past years what has happened to who I call the porn museum curator, but I hope that he is somewhere watching the next coming of Alien Invaders, Alien Invaders of the Anal Kind, part 26. Thank you, guys.
Yay.
Yes, very nice. Yay.
Pro.
There you go.
And thank you, Dixie, for helping me work on that story.
Oh my gosh, you're such a pro. I want to tell y'all, I have been following Amberly for a long time, and the content, the stuff that you learn from Amberly, who has been doing this work, how long have you been in the industry?
Ah, shit, I'm old. 16 years. 16 years.
16 years.
Yeah. I'm becoming the porn curator.
You are. You're so generous with your knowledge. I really appreciate how you teach people to make a living right now and how to get into the work they want to get into. Sex work is so important. Thank you so much for your story and for all the chaos that you just put up with. You did a fucking stellar job. Give it up again. Amber Rothfield.
Ma'am.
Nom boobays.
Oh God, I just had a dream come true. I have wanted Amberly for the longest time. Zoom will throw you for a loop. And you handled that with aplomb. Well done.
Thank you.
I think it is time for our final storyteller. He is based in Portland, Oregon. This is what I love about Zoom shows. Amberly's on one coast. Elena is in Seattle. Reed's in Portland. Grant is in Australia. Like, we can all come together and tell dirty stories and honor sex positive icons together in the same place, no matter where we are. Our final storyteller tonight is somebody who changed my life many years ago. He introduced me to Elena Gabosch long before I ever met her. He put me in touch with her long before I started doing a Seattle show, and she and I became friends on the internet before she started performing for me all the time at the Seattle show and helping me through the Center for Sex Positive Culture and everything else. Reed changed my life once upon a time when he crashed a storytelling soiree I threw in a place called the Ecstatic Attic. He got on Twitter and said, can I crash your party and bring my lesbian werewolf book writing partner? And I was like, fuck yeah. It was crazy. He was actually asking me the other day, what's my favorite story? And I'm like, I really love the story of how I met you. And the perverts who came to that party somehow decided that we had a fancy bartender. We also had ice cream made from liquid nitrogen. The perverts took all their clothes off, started covering each other with liquid nitrogen. One person said they burnt their nipple off, but it grew back. Suddenly everybody is naked on the third floor in the Castro in San Francisco. It was one of those parties that got completely out of control, and I exclusively blame him for that. Thank God. He is a relationship coach. He is an educator. He's the founder of Sex Geek Summer Camp. He has been flying around the world teaching for many, many years, co-founder of Cuddle Party, and adapting who he is constantly. He's one of my favorite people in the world. You're getting ready. Get ready for the sex geek. Here he comes. Applause, titties. Make some clap emojis. Make some noise for our final storyteller, Reed Mahalka. Woo!
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, Reed. Woo.
Choking on a dick saved my life. It's the pandemic, everyone. It has been over 200 and whatever fucking days. This is the longest time I have gone without group sex. I've had the blessing of group sex on a regular basis. And for a slutty, queer, polyamorous dude like me, it's been really important. And as I've noticed as the days have waned, this is the most monogamous Allison Moon and I have ever been. This is the most time we have ever spent together. And hanging out with Allison and our dog does not count to me as a threesome. And I fear that threesomes and their memory are leaving me. As the horniness increases, as the memories fade, I do what many, many other people are doing. I clean now. I organize things. I distract myself and I deny that the energy that is allowing me to be a busybody is really just a hunger, a starving, for multiple hands, multiple mouths and orifices, cocks in every hole, and I get busy. I have a garage now. I clean and organize my garage, and eventually my cleaning and organizing led me to my toy bin. My toy bin filled with sex toys. And as I brought out these sex toys, and I could almost hear when I opened up, I could almost hear in the bin the echoes of orgies past. There were the floggers and the paddles. There was the Enjoy 11. I lifted it. It's heft, heavy in my hands. It was almost like, oh. I pulled out dildo after dildo. I pulled out like several flashlights. One of them, the Avatar, you know, release of the fleshlight, which is just an alien blue hole that you fuck, and that's an experience. But I laid the fleshlights side by side. I started making piles. Here's what can go into the dishwasher. Here's what can't. And I just started like realizing, like, I miss my friends. I miss our orgies. When will we have orgies again? And then I reached into the bottom of the bin and I pulled out a dildo that has been talked about on body before. Back then, for my virgin little reed ass and throat and eyes, it was a large dildo. It is not the largest I own now. It had a suction cup on the back. It was the first dildo I ever had that had a suction cup on its back. And I told the story of a day when I was alone in the house and I was overcome with horniness and a need for something in my ass. And I realized that I had that dildo and I was like, oh no. And yet, oh yes. And I stuck it to the side of my little New York apartment shower. I stuck it onto the wall and I fucked myself and had my first crush on a sex toy ever. I felt dirty and great and I couldn't wait to scurry off and get alone time with my sex toy again. And as I held it, almost like the dildo of the covenant in my hands, and thought of these days long gone, I could see in my peripheral vision all the sex toys splayed out before me. And I realized I had been thinking about this all wrong. How many days did I let this happen when I didn't realize that you can have group sex with sex toys? Oh, I shouted and I grabbed the toys. I was like, what are we doing here? And I grabbed the ones because we had a shower upstairs, larger than the one in my New York apartment. The one upstairs is 3 feet by 4 feet, is completely tiled. And I looked and I saw the dildos that I had with suction cups. Now my old original dildo, that suction cup got torn off a long time ago. So I laid it down and I was like, I'm sorry, buddy. Today's not your day, because I'm a greedy, horny, pandemic motherfucker. And I am gonna have my way with some of these fine, fabulous toys. And so I picked two rainbow dildos with strong, sturdy suction cups on them. Girthy dildos, where like there's the nuts on the silicone rainbow dildo. And then the base from the nuts is thin, but not too thin, but then it gets girthy. It's like a dick that's like, it's girthy in the middle. And then there's like this beautiful little head on the dildo. So it goes in, but then you have to work. You have to work to get it in. But once you get it in, it's in and it kind of stays. And it's this thing like when you're fucking yourself and that girthy little thing happening, it's pulling on the back of your butt from the inside. It feels so good. For those of you listening who've never tried that, go slow. It's worth it. Maybe you like it, maybe you won't, but I like it. And I grabbed that dildo and there was his cousin dildo, the same dildo, rainbow colors that disappear and then reappear and then red, yellow, blue disappear and then blue, yellow, red reappear, but its cousin is bigger. And I grabbed that one and I'm like, yes, let's go bigger. Let's go girthier. Why not? It's the fucking pandemic. And then I'm like, okay, I've got my butt. I've got my throat. I've got suction cups. What am I going to do with my dick? Allison had left, by the way, so I was home all alone. And I said, oh, yes. I grabbed my favorite fleshlight. Not the alien fleshlight. I grabbed my regular favorite go-to fleshlight. It's the one where the company was brilliant in that they kind of created one that's like kind of the ejaculation trainer. If you want to learn how to not come too fast, it gets really tight. And it's got like bumps on the inside. I don't know what the fuck, but it feels great. I grabbed them. I scooped them up. I ran out of the room, and then I ran back in, and I'm like, lube, we need lube. Now, I can't use silicone lube because these are silicone toys. So I grabbed water lube, and as I'm running towards the shower, I'm realizing this shower is completely, completely tiled, and I'm about to like put lube over everything. This could be dangerous, Reed, but maybe you should film this for your friends, for your friends to see. So I jumped into my office, I grabbed a tripod, I started setting things up in the shower, and then I realized, you know what? You know what would be a horrible gift to leave your friends? A video of you dying in the shower while you fuck yourself silly with sex toys. And I was too horny to try to figure out all the tools that I needed for the perfect camera angle and the perfect lighting. I turned on the shower, I took off my clothes, I put everything in the shower, I jumped in, and I started trying to figure out what happens next. And for those of you who've had a lot of group sex, it's fucking difficult to get everybody in the right positions when you're trying to run a gangbang. And running a fuck is a lot of work, and not everybody gets to be relaxed when it's happening. And you've got to put the things on the right height, because I got to put the dildo right on the wall where my ass is going to be, but not where my ass is going to be when I'm getting onto the dildo, but where it's going to be while I'm fucking myself. So it's just at the right height and just at the right angle so that it's getting my prostate in just the right way, which also means 3 feet away, you have to put the dildo just the right spot on the wall for your mouth. So that it's, you know, it's easy, so that it happens fluidly, because the dildos can't change. It's not like, they're not like people where you can say like, please bend your knees a little bit more. So now the shower is steaming up. The dildos I think are right. I'm trying to lube things up. I'm using my body to block the water from hitting the dildos to wash off all the lube, because I need the lube to be on the dildos while the things are going in my body. And now I'm getting in position. I'm trying to get, now the water's too hot. I have to make it, now it's too cold. I'm trying to get it all right. I'm trying to get it all perfect. Well, I am so fucking horny now. I'm about to lose my mind. I start deep throating. Now, for those of you who know me, you know that I'm a fan of deep throating, and that when I am horny and I have things in my throat, it is the bat phone to the fuck button that is my ass. And it's like, hello, opportunity calling, put something in your ass now, Reed. And I'm like, yes, let's do this now. So I've got the rainbow dildo. It's going in my throat. My ass is like, bring, 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 pick up, please. Put the dildo in now. I'm like, yes, come on, hang on. Now I've got the dildo in. I'm face fucking myself. And as I go in with my face, my ass goes behind onto the dildo. Things are working quite nicely. The walls are perfectly spaced now. I've got my hands on both sides. I'm pushing and pulling. I start to slip. The lube has gotten to the floor. This is like the second act where the danger now increases. Am I going to die? But I don't care. I don't care. I reach for more lube. I reach for the fleshlight. And now I'm just, the dildos are the things that are keeping me stable while I'm trying to lube up my flaccid dick, because others of you might know that when you stick something in your ass, your erection might have a hard time kind of coming online. So I've got the fleshlight. I've got lube on my dick. I'm trying to jerk off. I'm so horny. I just need to fuck something, and I don't want it to be my hand. I've fucked my hand for so many hundreds of days. My dick's a little bit flaccid. So I grab my dick really hard by the base and get it just hard enough, because I've squished all the blood that's in it up to the head to get it into the fleshlight. I'm in. I'm in, and my dick starts to be like, oh, we know what we're doing. We can get hard for you now. And I'm like, yes, please, for the love of God, get an erection. I've got a dick in my throat, one in my ass, Now I'm finally fucking the fleshlight, and I'm fucking it, and everything's beautiful. And I'm like imagining, I've closed my eyes. I'm like, picture your friends, Reed. Picture your friends. One day you will see them. My feet are slipping a little bit, so I cram them into the corners of the shower. I've got my base now, and I am working it. I am working, and I start to feel it. I start to feel that sensation. I'm gonna come. I'm gonna come. And I'm so into it. And I'm gonna commit. And I'm getting closer. There are times in your life when everything lines up. Doesn't happen often. The timing's perfect. You're in the flow. Athletes talk about this. In that shower, on that day, that steam-filled shower, almost too hot, everything wet and warm, everything lined up. And as I start to come, my foot slips, but I catch myself with my one free hand, and then I fuck, and I'm gonna come. And as I start to come, my other foot slips. I jam my face onto the cock that's in my throat.
Yes.
I choke as I slip backwards onto the dildo on my ass, hitting my prostate perfectly. I black out. And for a split second, as I blacked out, my throat clenched so hard as to grab the thick side of that dildo before it slipped out of my throat. And I sat suspended for a moment by a dildo, suctioned cup to a wall of a shower, just long enough for me to come back to consciousness. As I pumped my pandemically charged load deep into my fleshlight. It was as if you remember strippers on stripper poles, when they slide down the pole, it was as if my throat were like the muscular thighs of a stripper, clenching the pole, stopping me in mid-fall for one brilliant moment. And choking on a dick that day saved my life.
Yes!
Yeah, incredible. Woo!
Woo! Wow. Yeah, Dick. All right, Dick.
You can find Reed on social media all over the place as Reed About Sex. He's been on Chelsea Does on Netflix. He's appeared on Oprah's Own Network. He likes to orchestrate orgies for television and other properties like that. And I think that number is not correct, because that number has said over 50,000 people have attended your workshops. And I've known you 10 years, and I'm pretty sure it said 50,000 when you started telling stories for me 10 years ago, Reed. I'm going to say it's 100,000 people have attended Reed's workshop. He's a great teacher. He has a lot of information cranking out constantly. He does Sex Geek Conservatory, where you can learn media skills. You can learn how to become a sex educator if you're thinking about making the world a better place. He's a great instructor. And as you can tell, he's really fucking entertaining while he does it. Let's make some noise for Reed About Sex. Woo!
Woo! Thank you.
Karen, I want to say something. I'm still here. I made it through the whole thing.
Is that Elena?
It's me. And I thank you, Reed. Just listening to you talk brings back some amazing memories of you and me. You are the bomb, and I love you very much. Along with everybody else here, I love everybody here.
Love you.
So love you.
We are going to end the night with music. Remember, he's from the future. He can tell us what lottery numbers and which horses to bet on. He is was in the UK and had to flee to Australia. He left many of his instruments as he tried to get out before things shut down during the pandemic. And I think he's doing a phenomenal job of pulling everything together. There's nothing like not having everything you want to do the best possible job. And he's known for his great job. He's top 10 at Edinburgh Fringe. And same thing with Adelaide and every other performance that he's done. So this is our final performance. I know y'all like looking at him, so make some noise for our final performance from Grant Bousset. Woo!
Yes!
Can I just say to our lovely St. Helena, even from the other side of the world, it's so obvious the amount of love that is in this Zoom call for you. So I just want to say, I hope your influence is eternal and your halo remains tight. I hope everything. I'm very happy for you with the sainthood. Let's bring this home, shall we? Yeah.
Okay.
Yay. So this is a song for all the exhibitionists watching. So let's gig it up. Baby, you know I think you're beautiful. We've had such a lovely night. I don't want it to end.
Oh, me too, Grant. You're so dreamy.
Why, thank you. Oh, I want you, babe. I don't think I can wait 30 minutes to drive you back to my place. Hey, you know it's late, and there's no one around. What do you say we lock the doors, turn up the lights, wind up the windows, and fool around a bit? But before you kiss me, I got something to say. I'm gonna rock your world as we rock the suspension. So push the seats back and we'll relieve some tension. Things will get hot and heavy. I'll be your love mechanic. We'll fog up all the windows and you do the Titanic. Cars are not just for transportation. They're a vehicle for mutual masturbation. Let's have car sex. Car sex. Car sex in the back of my Pontiac. Car sex. Car sex. Kick it. Car sex in the back of my Pontiac. Aztec. Now stop, someone's walking by. If it's the cops, we'll lie. We're just sitting passing time. Chatting's not a crime. All right, I think they're gone. Let's do this. You put your legs there, I put my ass here. You put your booty there. Let's start again. I put my legs here, you put your ass there. What are you doing? That is the stick shift. Let's try it this way, or maybe that way. Like, what if you get in the fetal position or something like that? Yeah, that's the spot. Yeah, right there. What are you doing? Put on the handbrake. Oh, this is so much easier in the movies. Just
just like, look, if you just get on top of me and I got a cramp. Just get on top of me and bob up and down and give me a kiss. Ah, fuck this. Cars are great for transportation, but they're a bitch for public fornication. Let's not have car sex. No car sex. No car sex in the back of my Pontiac. No car sex, sweaty Tetris. Car sex, smelly Twister. Car sex, lay in the back of my Pontiac. Aztec, I hope the moment hasn't passed. Cause I really want this night to last. So what do you say we go back to mine? Get comfortable and drink some wine. Let's have bed sex. Bed sex. Bed sex on my parents' king-size mattress. Bed sex. Bed sex.
Strangle.
Bed sex. Let's have warm and toasty in my snuggie. Bed. Not car, sex. Thank you.
Ruth.
There you go. I hope that was the happy ending that you need for the segue for your next the next show.
Y'all make some noise for Grant Busey, will ya? Look at that. And yay! As a performer who's exiled, there's that PayPal link so that you can help support artists who no longer have gigs in person until all of this is over. That was phenomenal, Grant. Thank you so much. Let's go back through our slides so that you can see everyone. If you did not do it the first time, make sure you use your phone, take a picture of the QR code, send them a tip, send them a meal, whatever it takes to help support each other at a time like this. And thanks, Marty, for making me look so good in that slide. How about Elena Gabosh? Make some noise. Woo!
Yes!
We love you, Elena. Thank you so much for being here tonight and telling us about your life. I'm so happy you were here. Amberly Rothfield. It was a great day.
Yes.
So good. Reed Mahalko.
Yeah.
Hey, there's me.
What?
Yeah.
If you want to know more about how to watch the new next body, listen to the podcast, all the links are there. You can tip me as well. Best thing you can do is support us on Patreon because that helps me keep Marty paying his bills as well as mine, because I could not do this without him. The live streams, the podcasts, all of that are his. In fact, Marty, do you have a slide for yourself so we can tip you? Look at that. There's no link there.
Yeah, hey. I'm just incredibly blessed, and I'm just so happy to be around y'all. And no matter what kind of problems we experience and what goes on, y'all are so kind to me, and it just makes me feel great that I work at such a place that I never have to worry about how people are going to treat me. And I just thank you all so much.
Oh my God.
Marty.
Thank you, Marty.
Marty.
It's not possible without you. This could not happen without you. Thank you for your art. Thank you for your talent.
Thank you, Marty.
Do you know that Marty had never been a podcast producer? He'd worked on stories, but he'd never been a podcast producer. And when he started working with me, we started winning awards constantly. And it's because of his talent. He makes music that goes into the episodes. He helps me pick the songs. He makes me sound good. He's so fucking talented. And as you saw, he deals with complete chaos on live stream and does it in such a cool way. Like,
he's amazing.
You're amazing.
Yeah.
Totally fun. Thanks for letting me be here, y'all.
So y'all, we're gonna wrap it up. Marty's gonna play us out with music. If you enjoyed this, please tell your friends about the show that's going to be on December 12th. That one's coming up soon. The theme is Happy Endings. We're probably going to get some full body sensual massage stories. But often, I've done this theme before, never as a live stream. Whatever you think would be a story that would fit that, if you have a true story, you can pitch me, dixie@bawdystorytelling.com. I work with storytellers. I help get them ready. And if you think this looks fun, I'd love to have you be part of it sometime soon. I am sexual folklorist Dixie De La Tour with the help of the inimitable Marty Garcia and tonight's talent, Grant Busey, Amberly Rothfield, Reed Mahalko, Elena Gabosh. All of these, thank you for coming and joining us tonight on a Saturday night. Thank you for supporting these performers and showing them love. We'll all feel a little bit less alone and more connected because you showed up, you turned your camera on, you spent the evening with us. I love you all, and I'll see you really soon.
Hey, we love you.
Yeah.
We love you.
Hey. We're gonna light up the night. Under death dance in the middle of the night. Can see the night skies in the mirror of your eyes. If you go dance, make sure you got the rhythm. Make sure that your heartbeat beats with the rhythm. I wanna run wild in the middle of the night. Right under the moon, but it's glowing in the night. Nothing in between our skins but the rhythm. Creatures of the night. If you go dance, make sure you got the rhythm. Make sure that your heartbeat beats with the rhythm. I wanna dance, dance in the middle of the night. And see the night skies in the mirror of your eyes. If you go dance, make sure you got the rhythm. Make sure that your heartbeat beats with the rhythm. The night time. In the dark, I wanna
wanna see you put your dick in the air, dick in the air. Let me see you put your dick in the air, dick. We stick our hands in the air and shake our asses like we don't care. We've been shaking our tits for years, so let's switch positions, no inhibition. Fear cracking your nuts, pistachio. Shave the handlebar, pistachio. Curly on top, Ralph Macchio. Went down, got milk, mustache, yayo. Dick in the air, let me see you put your dick in the air. Dick in the air, let me see you put your dick in the air. Dick in the air. Let me see you put your dick in the air, dick in the air. Let me see you put your dick in the air, dick. I know it's not subtle, I know you think I'm trouble, but I see you standing there with a moose knuckle. Although it makes me chuckle, loosen your buckle on the double. Face down, dick up, that's my command. Take it like a real woman, not Ayn Rand. Trickle down, drop. Give me 8 inches, pop, stop, you're gone numb. You need a lift, use a thumb, or take a fist. Roll with it, sissy fits, no hissy fit, or sissy bits. A gin fizz, for every his, now get to biz. Who's Jesus is? Who's Jesus is? Who's Jesus is? Put your dick in the air, dick. Dick in the air, let me see you put your dick in the air. Balls and dick, two balls and one dick. Balls, balls, dick, balls and dick. Balls and dick, two balls and one dick. Balls, balls, dick, balls and dick. Dick in the air, let me see you put your dick in the air, dick. Dick in the air, let me see you put your dick in the air, dick balls and dick. Dick in the air, let me see you put your dick in the air, dick balls and dick. Dick in the air, let me see you put your dick in the air, dick balls and dick. Dick, 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 dick.
Captain America said you gotta be like me or you're gonna wind up dead. That's at the end of your road, flat road, down and tired. You sleepy head, won't you go to bed? Let me run your line. Clark Kent ran for president. No one knew about the Zika thought in his head. First tried to take his life, accusation flew. Like Chris tonight, time's still looking good. What you gonna say to make everything alright? Lies, maybe right, maybe wrong. I'm in the middle anyway. Maybe right, maybe wrong. I'm in the middle. Shoot a hand, a barrel of thumb with a smoking gun. Heard round the world, war, the world. But a wonderful way to wait. Suicide lines, pay your fine, do your time. Let me run your life. Lies, maybe right, maybe wrong. I'm in the middle anyway. Maybe right.
That's weird.